our next talk is called GraphQL, Your Intuitive and Flexible Will Be Friends by Eva.
Hi, everyone. My name is Evis. And well, yeah, my topic today is GraphQL. And I actually have to just say that I'm a little nervous. This is kind of interesting way of presenting something because I'm standing in a room and looking at the computer and like not really seeing people. But yeah, before diving to the actual topic today, I'm going to say a few words about myself. So as said, my name is Evis. I go with pronouns she and her. I'm a front-end developer. If I can choose the stack, my dream stack right now would be maybe React, TypeScript, GraphQL, and some other libraries to there, depending on the case. I joined Futurist a little over a month ago. And yeah, I've been like really happy to be here. And it's been interesting times to start completely remotely. As a developer, I'm self-taught. And before beginning my career as a software developer, I studied Russian language and culture, and I actually have a degree in it. And there are some things that have stuck with me from those times. First of all, Russian music from, well, around late 80s, early 90s. So if you know bands like Kino, Zemfira, Nautilus Pompilius, and these kind of things, then like, yeah, you know what I'm talking about. And if you don't, I really recommend checking them. That's really good Russian music. Another thing that I still like, I'm happy that I studied Russian language and culture was because I learned a lot about Russian authors. And one author from basically Soviet times that is like really my favorite is Anna Akhmatova. She was a poet. She was born in Imperial Russia and lived her like almost the whole adult life in Soviet Union. And she was not the so-called Soviet author, but she was kind of like seen more like a problematic, and she was not accepted by the state. So she actually couldn't write these poems, but they were like her people around her memorized her poems, and in that way they could be published later. So yeah, also people around her really didn't like, they also had these kind of problems, I could say. For example, her first husband, Nikolai Gumilyov, was executed by the secret police, and then her son Lev Gumilyov and also her partner Nikolai Punin were sent to the Gulag, so to the camps, and Punin actually died there too. And because of these things, Anna Akhmatova became kind of like the one who described the feelings of those who were standing in the lines to get to know something about their relatives and people who just kind of went missing during the Soviet times. So not really a kind of happy life there. But I chose a quote from her here. I know beginnings, I know endings too, and life and death and something else I'd rather not recall just now. And yeah, if you've never heard of her, I really recommend checking her. And all the quotes in the slides are from Anna Akhmatova, even if I'm not like put her name anywhere here, but just telling. Okay, from Soviet Union to today's talk and the topic. So as said, this talk is about GraphQL, but it's in a way also about relationships. Because, you know, when you meet a new person or when you get to know a new interesting person, there are these certain stages that usually happen. First you meet them, then you get to know them. And then if your chemistry is good, there is always this kind of, I could say, a crush, even in friendly relationships. So this is not necessarily nothing romantic. And then like in this phase, it's also, we could say, a honeymoon phase. And when it's over, you start to realize that, okay, like those things you kind of thought that are great about this person, or maybe problems you saw as more like good features in that person are, well, they are actually problems. And that's kind of a time of conflict, I could say. And well, if you get over this time and this phase, then the friendship actually can mature and can be really like the real friendship there. So also when you get to know a new interesting technology, these same stages are there. Well, at least for me, they were when I was getting to know more about GraphQL. And today I'm going to share my journey to getting to know GraphQL through these five stages, and also share something about GraphQL, some facts, maybe opinions, to the first encounter with GraphQL. For me, it was, well, the year was something like 2016. And for storytelling purposes, I could say it was a dark and stormy night, or I could use an Ahmatova's words here, that we met in an unbelievable year when the world's strength was at an end. But well, to be honest, I think it was just another Saturday or something. At that time, I was still writing my master's thesis in Russian, and I was still like learning about software development, all the really like the fundamental stuff. And I wasn't working as a software developer yet. And this one Saturday, I came across this one site which had surprisingly lots of pink in it. And it really looked interesting, even the content. And if I'd known more about software development, I think I would have stayed on that page and learned more. But I was still learning really the basics. So I kind of like dropped it. And yeah. But as the year was 2016, I was pretty, in a way, pretty early with GraphQL at that time, because even though it was developed in Facebook internally in 2012, it was released to the public only in 2015. And actually after that, it has moved from Facebook to GraphQL Foundation in 2018. So yeah, my journey as an aspiring developer continued, and I was learning about all the stuff needed to get a real developer job, and I finally got that. And I can just say I learned a lot. And it was about maybe a year later, so maybe in 2017, when I came across with GraphQL again. And at that time, I started really learning about the tech and about the kind of the basic concepts. Okay, if you're here, if you're listening and you are actually wondering that, what is GraphQL? Like you have no idea. I can say like in short that it's a query language for APIs, and new concepts are easier to understand through something already familiar. I could say I could compare it with REST, because it's kind of like doing the same job as REST, but it has slightly different philosophy. And another thing to say here is that GraphQL is not tied to any specific database or any specific language, even though like many times when you see some examples about GraphQL, they are written in JavaScript. So that's just like GraphQL still is not a JavaScript related thing. You can use GraphQL with other languages too. And yeah, I could also say that when I was getting to know GraphQL or these basics better, I could say that my feelings were, as Ahmatova described, that I marvel at everything as if it were new. As said, GraphQL does the same kind of job as REST, but it has a different philosophy, and it's also working a little differently. And when you think about REST, how you interact with the API, you are using these HTTP verbs like get, post, put, and these to interact with resources. Well, GraphQL has these three actions that you can interact the data with, or how you can, like, what you can do with the data. So first of all, you can query data. So that's basically comparable to the REST's, like REST and GET of these HTTP verbs. So basically you are getting the data. Then mutations, they are when you are mutating data. So basically of those verbs, they are every, like all of the other verbs there are. Then there are subscriptions, which are, which is like, it's completely different from REST. And to find some concept here, I would use WebSocket. And actually it's using like at least in when using this one library, Apollo, it's the subscriptions are using WebSocket under the hood. But basically, you are subscribing to mutations in the back end, or of like mutations of data in the back end with this. So good example of subscriptions are Facebook's liking features. So when you have a post, you are looking at it, and somebody somewhere else likes that post, you instantly see that somebody has liked it. Okay, so we have the actions here, but like, how about the data? As REST is like has this resource, like utilizes these resources, GraphQL in a way utilizes types and has a schema which defines what you can do with the data in the API. Here we are defining, first of all, type poet, which has fields name, nationality, and literature movements, which are type string. And then born in and died in are numbers, and poems would be array of poem type, or which would be implemented here too, but I left it out to make the example a little shorter. Then there are these reserved types, query, mutation, subscription, which define the like what you can, for example, query from the API. So here, for example, you could query poets, which would return array of objects that have type poet, so or shape of poet, I could say. Okay, now we know what we can, or the shape of data we can query from the API. How would we actually get the real data here? For that, we would need resolvers so that they would resolve the data like according to the types. And here is a JavaScript example. And in this resolver function, you would have like you would get the stuff from the database or whatever to you need to make the object you're gonna return. So basically here, I'm just returning, just for the sake of an example, I'm returning an array of objects that are shape of poet. And in this exact example, it's just one object, which has like name that is type of string, so an Ahmatova, and nationality, which is Russian or Soviet, which is string, and so on. Well, I continued learning about the GraphQL, and I was really excited, and I really had this crush phase or honeymoon phase. And I think I could say that at the time, of course, I knew that no technology is perfect, but I still like now when I'm reflecting back, I could say that I maybe thought that GraphQL could be really like close to perfect, and maybe I was thinking that GraphQL would be the thing that brings the world peace and this kind of things. I don't know. It was that kind of like, I didn't see the negative sides of it at that point, or problematic. I wouldn't say negative, but problematic sides. But there were like, there why I kind of like was so excited and I'm still so excited about GraphQL is that, there are many reasons for this, but one reason is that with GraphQL, you can actually kind of like get what you need and not like more or in a way less. So basically a good example of this is that if we were building an app where we would have this like site or page where we would want to list all the poets we have in the API. So we just want to list the names of the poets. So actually we don't need anything else but the names from the from that API. With REST, well, we don't have any choice. We just like, if we had this REST API, we would just get poets from there and it would return us array of objects which has all the fields in it, or so like everything basically. And what we need is just the name. Well, with GraphQL, we can query for just for the name, and what we would get is just the name. So for example here, we would get the name Anna Akhmatova and also Marina Tsvetaeva, who is also poet from around the same time as Anna Akhmatova. All right, now we have built the page where we are listing the poems. And then we would want to build a detail page for every poet where we would need their name, but also we would want to have the kind of the titles of their poems. That's like with REST, we would have to first get the information about the poet. So their like object of having all these fields, and we again just need the name. And then we would have to make another request to get the names of the poems, or all the poems, not just the names, from the database. So with REST, we would have to make, well, in this case, we would have to make two requests. But imagine if we needed more information there, like comments for the, like, we have a commenting feature in there. And then we would want to have all the other poets that died in the same year or like whatever. And then we would have to make more requests, like one request for like everything we, every kind of feature or thing we would want there. With GraphQL, if the schema allows it, we would make just like one query, and we would get also the names of the poems and all the poets and like all the data with one request. All right. I got over like my honeymoon phase with GraphQL, it ended. And I realized that, okay, maybe GraphQL is not going to be the thing that brings the world peace, and like maybe we still need another solution, or yeah, I don't know, like it's still possible, but I like know that it's not that likely. And I realized that there are some kind of like problematic things or like things that, because for example, library is used with to like implement things with GraphQL, they are not kind of ready, and there are things that kind of must be implemented, and they are evolving all the time. And for me, one of the kind of like times that I can pinpoint when I realized that my kind of honeymoon phase was over and I was realizing that, okay, GraphQL is not perfect, was this one project where I was working with the front end, and we had the Apollo client as a like, well, library for GraphQL in the front end, and we were also using it for the state management. And it kind of like the documentation for Apollo client at that time wasn't so good, and like, okay, it covered the basic things, but we were doing something really like much more complicated, and that kind of like, well, diving into all these things and learning solutions, and yeah, it teached me a lot, but also I kind of realized that, okay, there are some things that are not perfect. And some things that we had really like problems with were like testing. I think like now it's easier and there is better documentation for it. And also we had some problems with the client state management solution, and especially with the cache of Apollo client. We managed to solve them, and I like really like it now. But yeah, also what I was, well, I didn't encounter this with the project, but what I've been reading and realizing that there are these two bigger problems, error handling in the front end side. So that it's related to the fact that GraphQL APIs, when something goes wrong, they like, okay, they return an array of errors, but they still return a 200 status code, and that can be problematic. Also, another thing is N plus one problem, and I'm not going to go into detail with that. I added some links to the end of the slides, so you can read more about it, because I think I couldn't even describe the whole thing as quickly as it should be in this time frame, but yeah, I added the links there. All right. But yeah, I got over all the kind of doubts, and like I'm happy to live with the problems of GraphQL. And I could say that we are now in the phase that we are actually starting our friendship, or we've been doing it for a while. So that's why I chose the quote from Anna Akhmatova here. So that your tender and loyal will be friends. And you might recognize that the topic of the, or title of the talk is kind of from this line too. Why I'm happy to kind of continue with GraphQL is that I still learn more about this kind of like advanced stuff. And okay, that project I mentioned, it was like, there were lots of problems, but also I learned a lot. And I'm really happy that we had that project. But few of the things I'm really excited about still, and what I've been kind of finding lately from GraphQL, and I want to share with you, well, state management when using Apollo Client. So basically, if you use Apollo Client library in the React app, or it can be used also in other front-end frameworks, but when you are using it, you don't actually, there's a big chance that you don't need any other kind of like state management solution, because Apollo Client's cache handles lots of these things that you would use state management for. And also one great thing about this is that if you have an, like you can add fields on the client side. So this means that if you have an e-commerce app, and you have you get the products from the GraphQL API, and then in the front end you would need to know if this certain product is in customer's cart. Data from server side, it doesn't tell you that, and it doesn't need to know that because it doesn't have to kind of do anything with the like things on the server side. But with Apollo Client, you can just add a client-side field or virtual field is in cart, and you can use it in the front end. And it doesn't, like when you are sending, for example, requests to the like mutations with this to the back end, it doesn't like even go there, because Apollo Client handles those client-side fields only in the client side. Another thing is directives. And actually, there are two that I'm going to talk to you about. First of all, client directive, which is connected with the state management. I just said a few words about, and then REST directive. So client directive. So that's the thing you would use for the said virtual field and querying it and handling the all these things that this virtual field in the front end won't be sent to the back end, actually. And then when you are configuring Apollo Client, and if you configure it to that you can use this REST client, it provides you a possibility to use the GraphQL syntax to query stuff from that REST API you have. So basically, if we were building an app with this Poet thing and we only had this REST API, we could use this REST directive to still like have GraphQL in the front end and to be used. And okay, if it's just like this one app and has this one API, then okay, there is no point, but if you have an app where you have multiple APIs and some of them are GraphQL APIs, and then there are some REST APIs combining these and just like having the like GraphQL queries as a like single source of truth, this helps with it. So yeah, all right, that was basically it. So if you like, there are a few things that I kind of hope you to remember from this talk, that GraphQL is cool, and okay, it's not perfect, but like if you've never checked it, I really recommend. And also if you've never heard about Anna Akhmatova or read her poems, I really recommend that too. And here are the links I promised. So thank you.
All right, thank you very much for your presentation.